Coming up on this episode...
All the world sees is the finished product. Just like, you know, there was 1.7 million spectators at that marathon. And that's all those people saw was the finished product. Our readers only see the finished book. They don't see all this stuff in the background. So I think they're analogous with the running and the writing. And if you train and if you study and if you do the things that you need to do, then you'll be turning out a great product.
Welcome to the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. There has never been a better time for writers. More information, options, and opportunities are available to you, but navigating these requires insight. Join Mark Leslie Lefebvre as he draws upon more than a quarter century of experience as a writer, a bookseller, and a trusted book industry consultant to explore and reflect on the writing and publishing landscape to help you make informed choices on your writer journey.
Hello, Reflectives, and welcome to episode 104 of the Stark Reflections on Writing and Publishing podcast. This is your host, Mark Leslie Lefebvre. In this episode, I have an interview with Valerie Francis, who's an author, a bona fide story nerd, a certified StoryGrid editor, and a podcaster. She has published fiction for both women, love stories for busy women, and children, middle grade fantasy, and she's currently working on her first thriller. Now, Valerie and I talk about her writing. We talk about how she managed to slowly transition from a corporate life and into a full-time writer-editor role. We talk about the challenge of doing all that as a single mom. We talk about her journey to becoming a StoryGrid editor and what StoryGrid editing is all about, and so much more. It's a great chat, and I'm sure that, like me, you're going to find Valerie incredibly inspiring. But first, a little bit of a personal update, and then we're going to hear a word from our sponsor. It is November 6, 2019, as I'm recording this episode, and as of this time, I have 18,526 words done on my NaNoWriMo project. Now, I mentioned, I believe, in the previous episode of this podcast that instead of actually working on a novel, I am working on multiple unfinished projects. So the very first project that I am interested in getting finished, and I need to get this wrapped up early in the month so I can get it off to my editor, is the book which I was thinking would only be about 15,000 words, but it looks like it's going to be well over 20,000. And that is the book called An Author's Guide to Working with Bookstores and Libraries. And I'm really excited about that one. I've been really going gung-ho on that one. I've got most of the words are for that particular project. Although, yesterday, which was on Tuesday, November 5th, I went to a Waterloo Region NaNoWriMo event. And that was with Vanessa, who was on just, was it last episode or the episode before? And she's the local moderator for the Waterloo Region. And there was an event, a two-hour event at the library. So I went to that event. I worked on, actually, I didn't end up working on this particular book. I worked on another nonfiction book project that I'm actually going to be talking about in a future episode. Again, it's about the writing and business of publishing, but it's a co-author project, and I haven't checked with my co-author to see if it's okay for me to talk about it. But I did about 1,800 words for that book, and most of that work was editing writing, so I was going through sort of a draft and adding in my bits and making some edits. So I only counted the words that I added when I was editing, as well as the paragraphs, etc., that I inserted. And I did about 500 words. There was a 10-minute sprint, and I thought it'd be easier on a sprint to just write fiction because there was a 10-minute contest that they had with everyone in the room. And I wrote a scene from a story that's going to be in my Canadian Werewolf in New York universe. It's probably going to be the story of how Michael and Gail meet, Gail being Michael's main love interest that he has not gotten over and still loves from the bottom of his heart. Now, in the novel A Canadian Werewolf in New York, I have a bit of a flashback to their first date and how Michael met Gail, and we know that he still loves her, etc., and they're just friends at this point in time. But I wanted to go back and explore the scene where they actually met and got together. I thought I would do the meat story of Michael and Gail. So I wrote 500 words from the opening of that story. And what I might do as little warm-up exercises go throughout the month, I might just continue to jump back into that because it's a lot of fun. And yet again, continuing to write in the Canadian Werewolf in New York universe is very important to me, and I want to do that. So that's some of the personal updates related to what I've been up to this month. One of the reasons I've gotten, right now at about this point in time, you're supposed to be at about 10,000 words, I think. And I'm at 18,000 words. And the reason I've been pushing really, really hard early on in the month is I know what's going to happen. Because it happens to me every time I do NaNoWriMo. I start off strong and then I just falter. So I'm getting up at 5 in the morning. I'm spending the first couple hours just working on the writing. And, you know, days like yesterday where I did spend an hour and a half at the library working on the writing. And I'll probably be doing a little bit more writing this evening after I finish working on the podcast. But I know that I'm going to be in Vegas next week, November 11th through the 15th. I fly out on the 11th, which is the Monday, and I get back on the 15th. So there's 2 days of travel there. And then I'm going to be at 20 books to 50K in Vegas from, you know, pretty much the whole week, the 12th, the 13th, the 14th. So it's going to be pretty hectic. It's going to be pretty busy for me. And I'm hoping I can still get some writing done early in the morning or sneak away. But when you're at a conference with 1,700 people there and lots of people to talk to, I really want to take advantage of that and actually spend time with people. So I suspect I'm not going to get as much writing done. So I really want to be well north of 20,000. I'd love to get closer to 25 or even 30,000 so that when I get back, I have 2 solid weeks to continue working. Now, again, I want to finish the work on the nonfiction book, The Author's Guide to Bookstores and Libraries, so that I can send that off to my editor who can work on that the week of the 11th. And then when I get back, hopefully, the returns on that will be done, so then I can also work a little bit on the edits, which will not count toward my word count, unfortunately. That'll have to be an additional project that I do on the side. But I think I like the pressure, because I went and put the book up for pre-order. Now, I just did the asset list pre-order, so I didn't do it on Amazon, and I didn't do it on Kobo, but I did do the asset list pre-order to all the other places via Draft to Digital, because I needed the pressure. I wanted to put the pressure on myself, and I think I set the publication date as December 13th. I was going to go with earlier in December, but I thought I'd give myself that extra wiggle room in case the edits come back and I end up having to redo some things. So I wanted to have that little bit of extra time for it so that I could actually have that out. But I think I needed the pressure. Maybe you need the pressure as well if you're doing NaNoWriMo. So that's it for my personal update. Let's first hear a word from our sponsor, and then I'm going to get into some comments. This podcast is sponsored by Findaway Voices. Did you know that Findaway Voices recently announced that you can now add keywords to your audiobooks? Keywords help listeners find your audiobooks in searches. This new metadata field is an optional but effective way to increase the visibility of your work on some retailers. Use keywords to provide more context about your audiobook that doesn't fit in the rest of your metadata. Useful information such as the tone of the story, the setting, or legitimate spelling variations are all great elements to add. You can add your keywords in the additional metadata section of your product's metadata page. Add them one at a time, hitting the Add button between each keyword. There's a character limit for keywords, so start by entering the most important ones first. This is just one of the many functions that you have available at Findaway Voices, which includes setting your own price for most retail systems, as well as the world's broadest distribution into retail and library markets. And you can learn more about Findaway Voices over at starkreflections.ca/findaway. And let me just go through a few comments that were recently left about the podcast. So for episode 62, which was the episode with Laura Crenshaw on expanding creativity with Cthulhu creation cards, Tinthea said, "I wonder what Hemingway would say about those cards. I believe he would say, just right, damn it." Excellent point, Tinthea. I actually, it's kind of interesting how sometimes we need those extra little things to get some writing done. I should actually mention, and I'll post a note in a link in the show notes, I should say, at starkreflections.ca, because Laura, who was on episode 62 talking about those Cthulhu creation cards, actually gathered together a whole bunch of, I think there's 10 of us who offer this free PDF pack to help inspire writers who may be in the midst of NaNoWriMo right now. So that's off of Cthulhu.com, I believe, but I'll do a link in the show notes so you can download the PDF. And in that, I actually included my short story, Distractions, which was a dark humor story about a writer trying to overcome distractions to get things done. He kind of takes it over the top in a darkly humorous, morbid horror writer sort of way. That actually appeared in my active reader digital chapbook. But, I mean, and honestly, Hemingway kind of did use something to just write, damn it, scotch. Because I'm sure he would have said, just write, damn it, as he lifted a glass of scotch to his lips. But I am not judging, because I enjoy a fine glass of scotch, and I often enjoy them in my Hemingway-branded scotch glasses that Liz's awesome daughters bought for me for Christmas several years ago that I still adore and love. I mean, I adore and love the kids. They're wonderful people. But I also adore and love the scotch glasses because they have Hemingway quotes on them. And I regularly do enjoy scotch while writing in the evening and other whiskey drinks. And a vodka drink, and a lager drink, and a cider drink. But I do enjoy other whiskey drinks from the scotch glasses, and one of my favorite ones, of course, is Hemingway's quote that says, "Write drunk, edit sober." Wow, that was quite a bit of a tangent from Tinthea's comment, but thanks, Tinthea, for leaving that. Additionally, for episode 92, which was a strong authors and the IP legacies they deserve with ML Buckman, Kathy Mack wrote, or Katie Mack, and I keep getting it wrong, my apologies. So Katie or Kathy, I think it's Katie, because key, K, the number 8, T-Y, that's Katie to me. So I'm going to call you Katie from now on. That'll be our little thing. Katie said, "I often listen to several episodes in a row while driving, so I'm not sure this is exactly the right episode for this comment, but it makes sense that it would be in the episode about maintaining your IP in good order, just in case." Good idea, Katie. "Over the episodes, you've talked to a number of writers who are now trying to get back rights they signed away earlier in their careers when, as relative unknowns, the chance of publishing an offset print book with an established press seemed worth the sacrifice of copyright. I'm in that boat," Katie says, "sort of. In 1995, I published, dated term alert, she puts in brackets, a hypertext, in quotes, created in StorySpace, which she says is an early digital platform, in the Eastgate Quarterly, who bought the rights outright. I balked at the time, but eventually signed because I wanted the publication. It came out on a 3.5-inch floppy disk, and it was delivered to my door by Fred Flintstone riding a dinosaur." My point is, it isn't just offset print publishers who look to buy copyright outright. And thanks, Katie, for that. Thanks for that, because it's true. I mean, we didn't know in the early days of publishing, 1995. And I love, absolutely love, your joke about being delivered to your door by Fred Flintstone riding a dinosaur. So thank you for that, and for that reminder that it's not always just print publishers. So thanks, Katie. And the final comment is actually came to me via a personal message from Talina Winters, who said, "I've actually been listening to your podcast for a couple of months and have really gotten some great inspiration and tips from it. Sorry I haven't left comments. A couple of times I wanted to thank you for sharing great information, but I find that the way podcasts are consumed don't make it easy or conducive to type a quick comment or reply, so I'm saying it now." Well, thank you, Talina, for sharing that. And I 100% completely understand. For example, right now you, yes, you, not Talina. Well, I'm talking to Talina if you're listening to this, but I'm talking to you, the listener, right now. You are likely listening to this podcast while you're in the middle of doing something else. Walking, driving, doing the dishes, ironing, walking the dog, not ironing the dog, running outside or on a treadmill, walking through the aisles of a mall or grocery store, pumping gas, pumping iron, sitting at your desk with headphones on and listening to this to block out the noise of your annoying desk neighbor who either breathes through their nose funny or is eating at their desk and just chews way too loud. One of those things, maybe. Raking the lawn. Shoveling the driveway. Shoveling the lawn. Sunbathing. Having your toenails done. What have I missed? How are you listening to this? Did I mention one of the things that you do when you're listening, or did I miss it? Come on. You're likely doing something else while listening. Let me know. Okay, that was a bizarre aside, because if you're like me, you likely do want to comment in some way, shape, or form, but you can't because you're in the middle of doing something else. I get it. I really, really do. I listen to a ton of podcasts while doing other things, and maybe only about 10% of the time do I actually remember to go back and return and comment or find the website, etc., because most of my podcast feed comes through automatic RSS feed, so I actually have to go to the website, which I rarely do. So, thank you, Talina, and Chad, who's previously mentioned the same thing, and so many others of you. I know you likely plan on commenting, but you forget about it, because you're thinking about it, and then 50,000 other things happen, and life, you know, happens, and you forget, and that's perfectly fine. And then you go, rats, I wanted to comment on that thing. It's all good, honestly. I still know that you're there, and I still know that you're listening. Yes, how do I know that you're listening right now? I don't. That's just the magic of this time travel that we're doing. I am recording this at 3:25 p.m. on November 6, 2019, and you're listening to this right now, exactly where you are and what you're doing. That's magic, isn't it? But I still know that you're there and that you're listening. And I have the download stats to prove it. I mean, that or somebody who really, really, really loves me is downloading a shit ton of my episodes. Oops, I swore. Better bleep that out. I'll have to go back and add a little bleep to that. Did I do it? If you're listening now and you heard the bleep, then you know, wow, he went back and did it. And if I didn't bleep it out, you're going, wow, he forgot to bleep that out. Again, this wonderful magic, but also yet another crazy aside. Sorry if I wasted your time with that little bit of aside, but thank you guys for the comments that you leave. You can leave comments of the podcast, if you remember to get back to it, over at starkreflections.ca. You can also at me on Twitter, at Mark Leslie, or I'm sure you can find me in all kinds of other social media places where you can share that comment with me. Well, that was a rather long introduction, about 17 minutes or so. My apologies for taking so long to do that, but wow, you're still there. You're still listening. I'm very impressed. You have a lot of patience. I admire you for that. But you probably stuck it out, or you fast-forwarded through some of it, just because you wanted to get to this fascinating interview with Valerie. But enough ado, enough preamble. You see how I extend that as I'm saying enough preamble and enough I do, and I just keep adding more ado? I don't know why I'm in a silly mood today or why this introduction was so silly, but I do want to get to this fascinating interview with Valerie that I know you're going to love. Hey, Valerie, thanks so much for joining me here today.
You're very welcome. Thanks for having me.
I want to dig right into your fascinating background getting into writing. Now, when we were talking earlier, you had mentioned it was about 7 years ago that you left the corporate world to pursue your writing journey full time, but you didn't just go cold turkey. How did that work?
No, well, I'm a single mom, and at the time, my kids were both in elementary school. So leaving the corporate world was enough to give my father, you know, many sleepless nights. So I first went down to taking my summers off, right, and I would write during my summers. And then I worked through the year, but I did a 3-day work week, and I sort of just petered out that way.
Okay. So you just, you negotiated with your employer to just drop down to part-time?
Yeah. Well, I worked for the federal government, so they had a number of programs in place. So I was eligible for the part-time one. So I just took it.
Okay. And what drew you into writing in the first place? Is this something that you've had as a lifelong passion?
Yeah, I've always been writing. I wrote my first book when I was 7. It starred my teddy bear.
Wow.
That's right.
It was an ongoing series, right?
No. Well, you know, it could have been, but it was just a one-off. Okay. And, you know, I would write poetry and music lyrics, and I was a musician as well, you know, before I got married and had kids. And so writing is just always something I did. And when I was 39, my sister said, okay, it's time. time for you to get at it now. So she would, there was a local writing group here, and she would look after my kids while I went to that writing class. So it was thanks to her that, that I started to dive into it. And then I realized I like this so much more than my day job. Why am I doing the day job? So I just left it and did this full time.
Oh, wow. So wait, you snuck in something that you were a musician. What instrument, or were you vocalist? What were you doing?
Jazz bass.
You mean like the big,
it was very hard to hold.
Oh, wow.
I had to sit on a stool because it was just too big physically for me to hold.
Okay.
But I also played piano, and actually that is something that I'm getting back into now because I really miss it.
So what is it about playing music? What is it about telling stories that drives you?
There's just something inside me that makes me want to do this stuff. You know, I can do the sciences. Well, I can do some of the sciences. I can do math. That's all fine, but I don't have a burning passion for it. If I'm not doing calculus on a given day, doesn't bother me. But if doesn't bother me at all. If I'm not writing or not expressing myself creatively, I start getting cranky.
Okay.
Frankly. And you know, I was also a painter and a visual artist. I never got into sculpting, although give me time. Give me time.
That's right.
That is just, you know, I'm a better mom when I'm doing this. I'm a better friend. I'm a better sister. I'm just much happier.
Oh, that's fantastic. That's fantastic. But you're not only a writer, but you also help other writers. And I know that you're a certified StoryGrid editor. So how did you get involved in that? And well, first of all, what is a StoryGrid editor for people who don't know?
StoryGrid is an editing method, a structural editing method developed by Shawn, Coyne, who was working with the Big Five companies for 25 years. And he is like you and I, Mark, he is a total story nerd. And he would have all of these manuscripts come across his desk, and he really wanted to develop the story and develop the artist. But of course, they're a business, and their interests were sort of clashing with the artistic interests. So one day he just said, I've had enough. And he left. And his business partner, Stephen Pressfield, Sean is also Stephen's editor. Steve said, you got to teach this editing method to writers because there's a huge need for it. And I am eternally grateful to Steve Pressfield for that. So what we do at StoryGrid is look at the structure of story. Yes, the pretty sentences are important. And I don't know about you, but when I was going through school, right up through my master's in English literature, I was taught that the sentences were the thing that you focused on, and you know, the description of the sun through the leaves of the tree and stuff.
Right.
And that's important. But if that's all your story has, it doesn't work. And if it doesn't work, that means people are going to put the book down and not get to the end of it. So all of those years of work that you've put into the book will be for naught, because I don't care what anybody tells me. They write a book for someone to read it, even if it's just their spouse or their, not just their spouse, but only for one other person to read it. Right. They are writing it for the purpose of having someone else read it. So that's what StoryGrid is.
Okay, cool. And how did you get involved in StoryGrid?
Well, after I wrote my first book, you know, there were parts, and I was writing on instinct. I didn't know anything. I didn't know anyone in the business. I didn't know anything about storytelling. I just knew that I wanted to tell stories. And I wrote the first book, which is a middle grade fantasy story. And I had a bunch of questions, and I was desperately going around looking for someone who could help me answer those questions. So I finished the book on the 23rd of December, 2014. And on January 2nd, 2015, I saw an interview on Joanna Penn's podcast, The Creative Pen, with Shawn Coyne. And I'd never heard of Shawn, but I knew that here was someone who had the answers to the questions I had. So I went to his blog. He was blogging his book at that time. And that's the StoryGrid, What Good Editors Know. When that came out, I read that, and I just started to consume everything that he was putting out, because every blog post, every interview was answering a question I had. Wow. So he did a live workshop in February 2017, and that was about love stories. That was in New York. So, you know, as a single mom, I made arrangements for friends and family to look after the kids and the dog and the cats in the house. And I went off to New York, and did this two-day workshop with him. And I mean, I have a master's in English literature. I learned more in those 2 days with Shawn than I did in my undergraduate and my master's. I thought, okay, I'm just going to hang with this guy for a while because there's so much I can learn. A few months after that, he opened up the certified StoryGrid editor training and I was in. I just said, here's my credit card, keep it on file. Whatever you're putting out, just charge it to the card. I'm in. So it took off from there, and that was 2 years ago.
Wow. And so you're not only still writing and producing your own work, but you're now also helping other writers with StoryGrid style editing.
Yeah.
How does that typically work? So if a writer's interested in learning more or wanting to work with you, how does that process work to see if there's do you have to see if there's a good fit?
I think it's really important to find an editor that you have a rapport with. I think that's essential because it's very much a partnership. The editor's not going to write the book for you, but they'll guide you. Like one of the other editors is my editor. As when I sit in the writer's chair, okay. Leslie Watts is my editor. And So she's a sounding board for me. And when I have a problem, she'll say, okay, well, what would it look like if you did it this way? What would it look like if you did it that way? And she gets me thinking. So that's kind of how the writer-editor relationship works. So when I work with clients, it depends on whether they have a manuscript that's finished already or if they just have an idea or they're in the process of writing a manuscript. Because we offer two main types of editing services. And one is the diagnostic. Okay. That's for people who have a completed manuscript. And, you know, I would read the whole book, every single page, and then I will analyze the first five scenes according to the StoryGrid principles, because the types of issues that you have in the first five scenes typically will be those that carry throughout the whole book. Okay. We'll analyze the genre for you. We'll have a consultation to say, okay, well, this is the story you wrote. What story were you trying to tell to make sure that there's a match? We'll give you a list of masterworks. And this is something that I find a lot of writers resist. And okay, I'm one of them. I was when I started. I have figured out now why Shawn keeps saying study masterworks. But the reason I resisted when I started is because it just seemed so overwhelming to go out and find a bunch of books like the story that I was writing, because my level of knowledge in this industry wasn't high enough yet to understand that whatever story it is I'm telling has already been told before.
Right.
There is most definitely a story like the one I am telling. I just haven't found it yet because even though I've been reading and writing my entire life, I wasn't doing it as a writer. And there's two, I don't know if you've noticed this, there's two different ways of consuming story, right? If you're just an audience member, like you go to a movie, you don't have to worry about the structure of the story. You're there to be entertained.
Right.
If you're reading a book as entertainment, you're just reading it as entertainment. But when you put your writer hat on and you go to that film or you see that TV show or that play or that book, you have to be paying attention to what's going on in the book. What's happening in the beginning hook? What story do I think I'm going to be told? We just did a film for the StoryGrid Roundtable podcast, which I'm on, where we analyzed a film because my colleague, it wasn't working for her. Just her spidey senses were tingling and she didn't know why. So she asked us all to help her study it so she could figure it out. So from the beginning hook, we thought it was going to be one type of story. And then it started to derail and they told us a totally different type of story. So that's the kind of thing that we do in the diagnostic. We'll look at all those kinds of things. The other kind of service that we provide is called developmental editing. And for anyone who has heard the StoryGrid podcast with Shawn Coyne and Tim Grawl, that's developmental editing. That's a weekly coaching call. For me, I get people to come in for a 6-month block because it takes that long to kind of get over the shock of studying story from this active structural point of view and to sort of get their fingers into it. So those are the two main types of services that we offer.
Okay. Wow. And so while we're talking about that, how can somebody learn more about that? Where can they find you? Where can they find out about how to investigate this story grid editing with Valerie?
My website is ValerieFrancis.ca. So if you go there, you'll find everything about me. There's some options across the top, and one of them is for writers. So if you go there, you can see the developmental editing and the diagnostic editing.
Awesome.
And while you're there, you can sign up to my book club.
Of course. But it's not enough that you're writing. It's not enough that you're editing. You also are involved in podcasting, and not just one podcast, but two podcasts.
Two.
Well, tell us about those.
So the first one is the StoryGrid Editor Roundtable podcast, which I just mentioned. And that started as a study group because, you know, when I went and did that two-day session with Shawn, it was intense.
Right.
I mean, as you can tell, I have no trouble talking. But at the end of those 2 days, I was so intellectually exhausted, I couldn't even form a sentence. Now, it was stimulating, it was exciting, but a lot of information. So when I got accepted to be an editor, I thought, you know, I better bring my A game to this. This is not for lightweights. So I went to a couple of the other people who went to the love story training and said, okay, are you going to the editing training? And if so, do you want to form a study group? And that's how we started, just as a study group. And it was so much fun and so beneficial that after our training, we kept it up to continue our skills. And the reason we started to record it is because at the training, Shawn, we told Shawn that this is what we'd been doing. And he said, well, did you record your calls? No. Didn't even occur to us to do that. So we started to record it for the other editors so that, because there were 19 in our original group, so that the other 14 could, if they wanted, benefit from what we were learning. And then they approached us and said, hey, do you want to turn it into a podcast? So it's essentially our study group that has been repurposed.
Wow.
Yeah.
So there's work you'd be doing anyways.
Yeah.
On an ongoing basis. And you're just leveraging that to share and help others.
Yeah. So I'm writing right now a psychological thriller. So last season I studied narrative drive because I needed to understand how narrative drive worked in order to make my novel work. This season, because it's a psychological thriller, I wanted to study other psychological thrillers to see what made them tick.
Okay.
So that's what I focused on. So that's the first podcast. The second one is the book launch show with Tim Grawl, and it's all about book marketing. And basically it's coaching calls where he's the expert and I'm the one who doesn't know about book marketing. And he's teaching me what to do. And if you go to, if you listen to the podcast and if you go to my site, ValerieFrancis.ca, you will see Tim's suggestions implemented on my site. Because that's the whole first season was untangling the mess I had made there and sort of, I really had a mess made because I didn't know what I was doing.
Right.
I didn't know anything about anything. I was just throwing spaghetti at a wall and seeing what would stick. So the book club that I started and a writer's life column that I started are suggestions from Tim.
Okay.
So if anyone out there is looking for ideas for developing a rapport with their audience, I mean, sign up for that if nothing else. You can unsubscribe later once you get a feel for it if it's not your thing.
Or but, like me, you can continue reading it and enjoying it.
That's right. And just to get a feel for what's there. So those are the two podcasts that I do.
So I want to go back to this podcast and on your website, you're exposing yourself. You're being very vulnerable, right? You're admitting the flaws. You're admitting the learning. You're showing the raw and then showing how you got. How long did it take to get comfortable with that kind of exposure?
A long time.
Yeah.
A long time. I remember someone saying to me, Valerie, you are now the product. And I didn't like that at all. I said, no, my books are the product.
Right.
And that held me back from a lot of stuff. And what made me get over it is that I have these goals, these career goals in terms of being a writer and being an editor and a storyteller. And I thought, I just have to do these podcasts in order to reach those goals. So get over yourself, get out there and get moving. And it took a lot of, you know, positive self-talk and a lot of psyching myself up, but it's getting easier. Absolutely.
Yeah. It's amazing. I think, we've known each other for a bit, but I think I was reading one of your recent posts And I was so inspired when I finished reading it that I had to reach out to you and say, thank you. This was inspiring. which reminded me that I hadn't had a chance to interview you yet for the podcast. But and that was about running, and you tied running into writing. Can you just share, because I found such value in that. I wanted my listeners to be able to benefit from a bit of that as well.
I think that running and writing are exactly the same type of skill. They require the same type of skills. I do run. Now, I hadn't run seriously in about 18 months. So even doing a 5K run put my ego in check, let me tell you. But I've done half marathons.
Okay.
My sister's a marathon runner. And I see the training that she puts in and the dedication that she has to that passion, because that's her passion. And it's exactly what I'm doing with my writing. These both are, they're long distance sports, right? Writing a novel doesn't happen overnight. It takes months, if not years, of dedicated practice. And just like a marathoner needs to pay attention to how much water they're drinking, what their nutrition is, what time they go to bed, all those little things that no one sees. Well, Mark, you and I as writers have to pay attention to the types of books that we're writing, the types of training that we're investing in, creating a consistent writing practice. I mean, these are all the little things that nobody sees. They only see the end product, right? Okay. Like when Diana did the marathon, I said to her, you know, it's showtime. All the rehearsal has been done. Now it's showtime. And that took a lot of pressure off her, because she realized, oh, okay, the work mostly is done. I just have now another 4 hours of running to do and I'm finished. So it's like, I mean that's so over my head. I'm like, yeah, just 4 hours of running.
In a row,
nonstop. Yeah. But it's the same with you and I. When we get to within 20 pages of the end of our book, right? That's when it's showtime. That's when you show if you're a pro or not. Are you going to hang in there and finish those last 20 pages, which sometimes can be the hardest 20 pages of the whole book? All the world sees is the finished product. Just like, you know, there was 1.7 million spectators at that marathon. Wow. And that's all those people saw was the finished product. Our readers only see the finished book. They don't see all this stuff in the background. So I think they're analogous with the running and the writing. And if you train and if you study and if you do the things that you need to do, then you'll be turning out a great product, right? Like Diana finished the marathon. She wasn't even sore the next day. She didn't even look tired, you know? And how many writers are there who limp to the end of their book and think, never again, never again, I'm never writing another novel, versus someone like J.K. Rowling or Ian Rankin or any of those A-listers who just say, yep, okay, that one's done. Tomorrow I start the next one.
Right.
Nothing to it. Nothing to it.
Nothing to it. I love that. Thank you. You see, you re-inspired me again. So I read it a week or so ago, was inspired and motivated and pumped up. And now you got me all pumped up again. So thank you.
Oh, good.
And when I listen back to this, it's going to do the same thing to me. So thank you. So
you're welcome.
In that vein, when you started writing, you single mother, little people in your life. Mm-hmm. And yet I want to come back to, there are a lot of people out there who aspire to run that marathon and finish that novel or get that done. As you and I are talking, it's about to be NaNoWriMo. We were close to November. And so there's a lot of people thinking, hey, maybe I can do it. Maybe I can write 50,000 words. Mm-hmm. What sort of advice would you send to that single mother or the person who's working a full-time job and has family commitments and all kinds of other things that they're trying to balance, particularly because you balance so many things? What sort of advice would you give to that person who's sitting there looking at that daunting marathon of a book in front of them?
Take it one day at a time. You know, we as humans, no matter what the activity is that we're trying to do, we look at the road ahead and it's so long. And, you know, you're wondering, is there a light at the end of this tunnel or not? It's only ever today. So if you do today what you can to move the yardstick a little bit forward, then that's a win. That's a win. I did on the Roundtable podcast, we have these bite-sized episodes sometimes, like 15, 20-minute snaps. And I have one, I think it's called It's Always Today. And it was about developing a writing practice. Don't worry about next week. Don't worry about a month from now. What block of time are you going to sit down today and do? And it might be different every day. Like when I started, it was, I mean, you know, every day was different. There was no structure. I was flying by the seat of my pants for a very long time. So I would, the night before I went to bed, I would say, okay, when will I write tomorrow? Okay, tomorrow I can do it between 12 and 12:30. Or tomorrow I got to get up a half hour early. And it was half hour blocks because that's all I could fit in. Anyone listening who's a single parent will understand completely. And then now my kids now are 16 and 20. So it's a little easier now. Now this is my full-time job. So I do a 4-hour block a day. But when you start, just worry about today. One day at a time, and you'll get there.
Okay. Awesome. Thank you. Now, you mentioned 4-hour block. Because you have two podcasts, and you write, and you work with writers as an editor, how do you block your day off? So 4 hours is for what specifically, and how else do you block the day?
I had to prioritize all the activities. So my number one priority is writing new material.
Okay.
Because if I'm not doing that, everything else falls apart really quickly, right? Yeah. So I write for 4 hours a day, usually two-hour blocks.
Okay.
Because I just am not physically designed to sit still that long. So again, still what I do is the night before I plan out my activities for the next day, and I write down 6 goal-achieving activities for the next day, and I prioritize them.
Wow, 6. So the
6. I might not get through all 6.
Okay.
But I might only get through the first one, but that's the first priority. So if I only get through that one, then that's fine. So I'll get up at 5. I'm usually at work by 5:30, if not 5:20. And I write for 2 hours. Then I go to the gym. I come back, write for 2 hours. And because I live in Newfoundland here on the East Coast of Canada, I'm in the first time zone in North America, and that's to my advantage.
Yes.
By the time I get all that done, my writing, and go to the gym, the rest of you are awake. You know, and then the Story Grid people are starting to look for me. So my afternoons then are spent doing the things like the podcast and the other work I do for Story Grid and working with clients and so forth.
Okay. Interesting. So you divide the personal stuff that you can do on your own in a time of day where you're not going to be bothered by other people, or not bothered, but not going to be having to interact with other people because everyone else is sleeping.
And then, okay, nobody's looking for me.
Yeah, that's right.
And my mind is clear when I wake up, and I'm a morning person. I have written late at night. I've written through the night because you know this, Mark, as a writer, when there's a deadline coming, the deadline's coming and you got to meet it. Yeah. You don't miss your deadlines. So we learn how to write anywhere, anytime by necessity.
Okay.
So I can write in the coffee shop or in the car or through the night or whatever. It's not, you know, if I had my druthers, that's not what I would do. I would do it in the morning because I'm a morning person. I'm freshest. My mind is clear. I can just get up and go.
Awesome. That's fantastic. So I want to go back to your writing specifically. Is there a recent available? So if we pique anyone's interest, they can pick it up. Is there anything that you have recently produced that you're really passionate about and want to share?
Well, I have fiction and both nonfiction.
Okay. Well, why don't we pick one of each? That sounds like a good plan.
So for fiction, my latest novel is Masquerade, and it's a story in 12 parts. And the reason I did it in 12 parts, I call it a love story for busy women. Because I was at a dinner party with my girlfriends who are avid readers, but all have kids now and jobs, and they're volunteering and all this other stuff. So reading fell off their list of things to do because they would look at a novel and think, that just looks like another thing to do. You know, that better be a really good book because that's, you know. So I kind of wrote it for them and I wrote it in 12 parts. So each one is about the length of a glass of wine or the soak in a tub.
Oh, that's perfect.
20, 30 minutes. You can read it on your phone if you're in the dentist's office or waiting for a kid to get out of rehearsal. Just easily read it on your phone.
Okay.
And because it's only about 10,000 words, it's not a big commitment. right?
I mean, is it 10,000 words per story?
Per story.
That's fantastic. Yeah. Oh, wow. Okay.
So digitally, they can get it. Right now, I've got it in Kindle Unlimited. So okay. you can get it there. I'm in the process of creating a print book, which should be out in a couple of weeks. Might even be out by the time this podcast
probably by
airs.
The time this airs, yeah.
That will be available everywhere.
Awesome. Fantastic. And since most people do read in print still, mm-hmm. this would be a great opportunity for people to grab the book and keep it with them for those glasses of wine, those soaks in the tub.
That's right.
Standing in line at the grocery store.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I really put a lot of work into the design of the print book because, I mean, I love print. I do. I love digital, but I also love print. But because space is limited, I invest in books that are worth investing in.
Right.
And I think that when you read a novel in paper version, it should be a pleasant experience. Okay. So I've got each one of the 12 sections has an illustration to kick it off. I've paid a lot of attention to the font, to the spacing, all that kind of stuff, so that visually it's a nice experience.
So I have to ask, because for anyone watching the video, there's books behind you, there's books behind me. Given limited space, how do you determine? Is it the visual, or is there a preference for fiction over nonfiction when you decide you have to own a physical copy of that book?
Well, it depends if I'm going to use it as a reference, really. So okay. for nonfiction, my writing reference books tend to be in print because I'm, you know, dog-earing pages and I'm writing and stuff.
Right.
You can't see them. There's also bookshelves going down this wall, and there's a bookshelf all along the other wall, bookshelves out in the hall, lots
well,
of books.
It's great for acoustics too, right? Not just right. looks great, it's insulation and it's acoustics when you're recording.
That's right. So for my nonfiction, if it's a book I'm going to be referring back to, I tend to get the print version. Also okay. to give my eyes a little bit of break from the screen, because like you, I do a lot of screen work. For novels, it depends on the writer. I'm going to buy whatever Neil Gaiman is putting out.
Okay. But,
you know, I don't even ask what the thing's about. I just buy it and figure it out later. I'm like that with Ian Rankin as well. You know, there's a few, Margaret Atwood, there's a few books, a few writers like that, that I really love to go to. And I'm picky about the format. I don't like paperbacks. I don't like physically holding a paperback. So right. I will look at the book and hold it and see if it passes muster.
Fair enough. Now let's talk about your the nonfiction book that you're most excited about right now. Your book.
Well, I'm working on, I have a number of articles on the StoryGrid website, Fundamental Fridays.
Okay.
So writers can go check those out. But I'm working on a book right now, StoryGrid Start to Finish. And it's the process of using the StoryGrid methodology from the beginning, from the idea all the way through to the end. Because okay. it was developed as an editing tool, right? So Shawn would have a manuscript completed, hand it to him, and he'd have to sort through it.
Right.
But it works just as well when you have just an idea and you want to develop the idea. Really? So that's what I'm doing. And if anyone is interested in this, if you're already familiar with StoryGrid, if this is something you're curious about, I created an inner circle. It's really inside baseball. ValerieFrancis/innercircle. Go there and you can follow my process as I'm doing this. Like right now I'm working
as you're working on this book.
Yeah. It's, wow. I mean, it's not the thing that everyone is going to be interested in. Most people don't really care. Yeah. But if you're curious about StoryGrid and how you can apply it as a writing tool, as well as an editing tool, sign up there. And right now I'm working on a foolscap. So I'm showing you how I'm studying masterworks and why I'm studying them, what I'm trying to figure out from those masterworks, and how that informs the foolscap that I'm creating.
Wow.
So that book should be out next year, knock on wood.
So in 2020.
In 2020.
Oh, awesome. And what about something of yours that in nonfiction that is already out there and available now as we're recording this?
Those would be the Fundamental Fridays posts.
Those articles that, and you'll send me links so I can include those in the show notes.
Yeah, and they're all on my website as well.
Okay, oh, perfect.
But I'll send you links to the ones that people tend to look for most often.
Okay, awesome. Well, thank you. Valerie, thanks so much for taking the time to re-inspire me multiple times today, as well as take the time out of your busy schedule. And I know this is the morning for you still, so taking time away from your personal writing. So thank you for doing that.
You're worth it, Mark.
As you probably suspected, because I pulled the quote out and used it at the very beginning of the episode, but I love the fact that Valerie talks about all of those things, all of those efforts, all of those details and the blood and the sweat that goes into writing, comparing it to a marathon. And people only see the finished product. They do not see the years of dedication and hard work. They do not see the angst and the way that you maybe struggled over cutting a scene or removing a character that you really liked but didn't bring anything to the plot, or you had to go back and rewrite something maybe a dozen times just to get it just right. All of that extra effort that you are putting into your writing that is never seen, just the end product is seen. And that's it's an amazing reminder, particularly if you are participating in something like NaNoWriMo and you realize all of the effort that you put in just to see if you can get 1,666 or 67 words done every day, or 100 words every day. All those little things that add up to your overall career. And I think it's a really amazing reminder. And Valerie, I mean, talking to her, listening to her podcast, reading her newsletter, I find so inspiring. She has such an amazing perspective. And I love the fact that I was re-inspired. So I reached out to her because I'd wanted to have her on the podcast. And then I got her newsletter and I responded to the newsletter and said, oh my God, this is awesome. I'd love to talk to you about this. And then, you know, when she was talking to me about it, I was re-inspired. And then, of course, as I was re-listening to this while I was editing the audio, I was inspired a third time. And I love the fact that you can be re-inspired by the same thing repeatedly. And maybe the first time I was inspired by Valerie, it inspired me in one direction, and the second time in a slightly different direction. And I love the fact that you can draw upon this amazing well of inspiration from a single person like Valerie and find different things to take from it. So going back to your notes that you took maybe years ago from maybe a workshop you had attended, maybe something you did when you were studying the craft of writing, maybe it was a conference you had been at, maybe it was a podcast you had listened to. Going back and re-experiencing that is sometimes really, really worthwhile because of the new inspiration that you can get from it. I was listening back to the episode with Vanessa on NaNoWriMo, and that inspired me to actually get up out of my chair, to actually leave the house, to actually go to the library where I did some unique writing. And I met some interesting people. Now, I wasn't very social because most of the time was spent chatting, but it was really cool to see the other writers there. And there was something about seeing those people. There was something about sitting in a room where a whole bunch of us strangers, I mean, some people knew each other, of course, but we just came and sat there and we were all just being writers together. And it's interesting because writing is such a solitary task. And of course, we're all sitting at our keyboards, or some people had notepads that they were writing in. And we were all in our own little worlds, but we all knew that just to our left and just to our right, and in that room, there was another dozen people who were going through the same process we were. They were pulling words together in their mind and putting it down on either physical paper or digital paper. Absolutely amazing. But again, I was re-inspired to go do that, and I had an amazing experience doing it when I was listening back to the interview with Vanessa. So think about the things that you have learned in the past that you may want to revisit and be re-inspired by. I'm sure that sometime in the future, I'm going to listen back to this episode and I'm going to be re-inspired one more time by Valerie Francis. And finally, I wanted to offer a shout out and a thanks to all the patrons of the Stark Reflections podcast. You guys are amazing. For as little as $1, $3, or $5 a month, you guys are helping support the show, and I truly appreciate you doing that. Now, I did recently release an episode, an audio-only episode, which was reflections on other podcasts, and that was a reflection on, oh my goodness, I can't even remember, because I just recorded two unique reflections. One went out this past week, And there will be another one coming out next week. And of course, I was just listening to another podcast earlier today, and I've made a note that I want to clip a bit from that podcast and reflect on it. Because again, I can be inspired by so many things, and I want to share those with you. And I want to share those, obviously, with the patrons who are putting in extra effort to support the show. You can support the show via Patreon over at patreon.com/starkreflections, or you can support the show just by commenting or by sharing this podcast with someone that you respect and think will get value out of the podcast. Now, I will be releasing, or actually, I will be recording episode 105 of the podcast to be released next week, which will be coming out on Friday, November 15th, but I'm going to be in Vegas. So that is something I'm going to be recording before I leave my home of Waterloo, and that'll be scheduled for the post. And that's going to be a fascinating interview that I have with a gentleman from VoiceMap. And I'm also going to share a personal update related to audio that I'm really, really excited about. And I got a chance to nerd out about it with Joanna Penn when I was in Vegas. So in the next episode, in 105, you're going to hear an interview with VoiceMap and this great new opportunity for writers related to audio. And you're also going to hear a bit of an update on what I've been up to with AI and voice. So, until next week, at least for you, for me it's probably just going to be about 12 or 14 hours, but until next week and episode 105, this is Mark Leslie Lefebvre wishing you great writing and good Stark Reflections.
Thank you for listening to the Stark Reflections podcast. You can find show notes for each episode at starkreflections.ca.
The music for this podcast, Laser Groove, was composed and produced by Kevin MacLeod. Check out more of Kevin's great music at incomptech.com.